She was an African-American woman who came from humble beginnings. She would have been completely forgotten after her death in 1951 if not for one important fact. Her cells are still alive today, and they've been used for over half a century for cutting-edge medical research into polio and cancer. This in spite of the fact that her surviving family can't even afford their own medical care. This amazing story is told in a new book, The Immortal Life of Henrietta Lacks. This is a conversation with its author, a conversation with Rebecca Skloot. Funding for this program is provided in part by the WKNO Partners in Excellence Fund, committed to presenting quality programming, and by viewers like you. Thank you. Since its release, The Immortal Life of Henrietta Lacks has been garnering rave reviews. For example, the New York Times said this, "It's as if somebody has been able to distill and purify the more addictive qualities of Aaron Brockovich, Midnight in the Garden of Good and Evil, and the Andromeda Strain. It feels like a book that Miss Skloot was born to write." That's an amazing review, and they don't give reviews like that lightly.
No, they don't. And it was, the response to the review was pretty amazing. And people would show up at my events every once in a while with the reviews, saying, like, did you see this? Will you sign this? And it really was, it was amazing.
Well, this is such a rich story that we should really start at the very beginning. Who is or who was Henrietta Lacks, and why is she so important?
Henrietta Lacks was a poor African-American tobacco farmer who grew up in Southern Virginia on the same plantation where her ancestors were slaves. And she eventually moved up to Baltimore, where in 1951, when she was 30 years old, she was diagnosed with cervical cancer. And she went to Johns Hopkins for treatment. Before treating her, without telling her, her doctor just took a little piece of her tumor and put it in a dish. And he sent that down the hall to George Guy, who was the head of tissue culture research at Hopkins. And George Guy had been trying to grow human cells in culture for decades, but it had never worked. And for some reason, Henrietta's cells just never died. So they're still alive today, growing in laboratories around the world. They've been, the amount of them that have grown from that one little tiny sample is just sort of astonishing. There are estimates that say they would weigh more than 50 million metric tons if you could put them all together today.
That was one of the startling startling statistics at the beginning of the book. In fact, you have more than than just that. I think you looked at it in almost global terms.
Right. There was one scientist who said that they would be able to wrap around the Earth at least three times if you laid them end on end, and that was a long time ago, so it would be much more now. Mm-hmm. And they were one of the most important things that happened to medicine. They went up in the first space missions to see what would happen to human cells in zero gravity. They were used to help develop the polio vaccine. Her cells were the first ever cloned. Her genes were some of the first ever mapped. We can trace some of our most important cancer medications, drugs for Parkinson's. I mean, the list just goes on
just
and on.
Just amazing. When did you first hear about these cells?
I first learned about them when I was 16 in a basic biology class. This was in the 80s. And my teacher said what most biology teachers say at some point, which is there are these incredible cells. They've been alive since 1951, even though this woman died a few months later. And they were one of the most important things that happened in medicine. And he, for some reason, knew her name. And he wrote it in big letters up on the board. And he said she was a black woman. And then that was it. And he erased the board. And I went up to him after class. And I was like, well, what else do we know? And who was she? And what did her children think of this? And I want to know more. And he just said, sorry, that's it. Nobody knows anything. And it just stuck. I sort of became obsessed with the cells from that point on.
Now, in telling the story, you talk about the fact that Henrietta diagnosed herself, basically.
Yeah, one night she just went into her bathtub after she'd found bleeding between her cycles. Mm-hmm. She went into the bathtub and just used her finger and felt the surface of her cervix and found this lump there and went to the doctor and said, she called it a knot. And she said, I've got a knot on my womb and the doctor needs to take a look. And they were just like, well, What makes you think that? They just thought she was crazy. But she was right, and they found it exactly where she said they would.
Yeah, and apparently it had been growing for a while.
Yeah, it's probably her cancer had been around for quite a while. It was caused by HPV, the virus that causes cervical cancer, even though we didn't know that then. And like many African-Americans, particularly in the 50s, particularly without money. She didn't have much preventative care. She didn't really go to the doctor very often. So by the time the tumor was actually diagnosed, she was pretty late in the progress of it, and she was showing symptoms. And so there really wasn't much the doctors could have done for her at that point. If it had been found earlier, maybe, but.
Well, it goes back also to the context of health care in the early 1950s for African Americans. I mean, at a certain point, she almost felt lucky that she was getting any care at all.
Yeah, so she ended up at Hopkins, which was one of the top cancer centers in the country. But the only reason she went there was because it was the only place she could get treated anywhere near where she lived, because the hospitals were segregated. And Hopkins, they called it their public wards. They saw black patients, poor patients, people who couldn't pay for their bills. They saw them there where most other hospitals wouldn't. So she was seen in the colored ward, and put in colored exam rooms. And when they took blood, that went in the colored refrigerator. And when she died, she went in the colored freezer. And so it was very segregated. And in a sense, I think there was this. The attitude at the time was they're lucky to be getting treated at all.
And you also talk about the radium treatments, which, quite frankly, made me cringe. It just was so.
Yeah.
It's only 50 years ago. I mean, in a sense, it wasn't that long ago or longer. But in one sense, it just seemed medieval.
I mean, this was really early in the days of radiation therapy at all. So the doses that people were getting of this stuff was much higher than you would get today. So the side effects were much worse.
She was a tough woman.
She was.
I mean, you talk about her walking long distances to get to the hospital, and then going home after the treatment, and it's like nothing happened. I mean, she would just tell everybody she was fine.
Yeah, and take care of her kids. She had five kids, and one of them was born epileptic and deaf and had various other problems. And so Henrietta took care of her constantly. She was having seizures all the time, and she also took care of everyone else. So she was sort of the neighborhood mother.
One of the most affecting parts of the book is the description of what she went through towards the end. And in fact, there was a quote that just jumped off the page. And it describes Henrietta rising out of the bed, wailing like she'd been possessed by the devil of pain himself. And that came from one of the family members.
One of her cousins, who'd visited her in the hospital. Her death was incredibly painful. And at the end, they strapped her to the bed and would put, pillows in her mouth so she wouldn't bite her tongue, because she would flail in pain. And that part of the book, that was the hardest thing I have ever written. I mean, to bring a moment like that to life and to actually put you in the room while she's dying took sort of going there myself over and over again and reading through her medical records and really kind of living that moment in a way. And I think after I wrote that, the scene where she actually died and the lead up to it, I just sort of went and laid down, and I think I didn't move for a couple of days. I was just, it took everything out of me to write that.
This almost refers to what the New York Times reviewer said was the midnight in the Garden of Evil, a good and evil part of the story, which is at the funeral. Mm. It's at the funeral when they think they see a sign. Describe that for me.
Yeah, that's such an incredible moment. The day that she died, she was buried in an unmarked grave behind the house where she was raised in Southern Virginia. It's just in this field. And the way her cousins told the story, they said, the moment that the first handful of dirt hit her coffin in the ground, the sky turned black, and there's this incredible storm, and it ripped the roofs off of houses and crushed a few people, and it was just this epic mythological storm. And her cousins later, when she died, no one knew about the cells. Her family, they had no idea. But many years later, her family would say, this was Henrietta giving us a sign. This was her telling us that something was going on. And, that one of my favorite lines in the book is actually her cousin in that moment saying, Henrietta never was a beaten around the bush kind of woman. Like, she was trying to tell us something with that storm, and we didn't notice until a long time later. And as a writer, recreating that scene, the first time I heard it, I was like, yeah, right. That's just like this. That's just too good, really. You know, just sort of metaphorically speaking. And so I found every person who was still alive who was at that funeral. And I would just say, "Tell me about the funeral," and they would all say, "Oh, the first handful of dirt went on, the sky turned black," and just over and over again, I heard the exact same story.
That's what makes the book so good, because sometimes one of the admonitions that editors have for reporters is beware of the story that's too good to be checked out, you know, and that's almost so good, that could have been a pitfall if you didn't get that back from the family members.
Yeah, oh, I feel incredibly lucky to have come to the story when I did, because so many of her family members, her generation, was essentially dying off as I was doing my reporting. They were in their 80s. And, you know, I felt like I was capturing history right as it was vanishing.
Now, you talk about how important George Guy was to this particular story. And you're very good in the book about not making any kind of judgments at all about anyone in the book. But I was left with a kind of impression about George Guy. I had the impression at a certain point that the ethics of this situation, taking the cells away from Henrietta, not getting informed consent, that the ethics of this began to weigh on George Guy over the years, and he began to reposition the narrative of what happened. I mean, that was purely my impression, and that never came from anything that you said. There were certain stories, for instance, George Guy in the deathbed conversation with Henrietta. Tell us about that.
Yeah, so that's an interesting moment in the book. That's the really one moment that I couldn't get any verification beyond the one person who said that it happened. And everyone that I talked to who knew George Guy said he never met Henrietta, he never talked to her, he didn't even know who she was. But this one woman who worked with him, a researcher, she said to me, "Oh yeah, he told me that not long before she died, he went to her bedside and said, you know, essentially, thank you, and your cells will make you immortal, and they'll save millions of lives, and you know, your legacy will live on forever." And that Henrietta responded by saying she thought that was great. And I say in the book, no one else was ever able to verify this.
Right.
Everybody else said that he didn't do it. Where you do with that is sort of your own, you know, is up to you. But you know, I don't see any reason why she would have made it up, or that he would have made it up. He definitely wasn't the kind of person who would tell stories like that if they didn't happen.
But there was a certain irony in that also, because a guy seemed to work pretty hard to make sure that her identity was never known.
He had never been particularly careful about not telling people her name. So he named the cells Hela, which is H-E-L-A, which is an abbreviation for Henrietta and Lax. And he, you know, told various people her name, and eventually the press got a hold of the story, and when her cells were used to help develop the polio vaccine, this article ran in the Minneapolis Star that said, you know, cells from one woman named Henrietta Lakes were this incredibly important thing. And then a bunch of other journalists started contacting Guy saying, "We want to talk to her family, we want to tell their story." You know, this is 1954, and at that point, George Guy and various people in Hopkins said, "Oh, wait a minute, we probably shouldn't do that. This could get us in trouble." They never said what trouble they were worried about, but that's when they put out a pseudonym, which was Helen Lane. So to this day, you know, until they hear about this book, most scientists still think that the cells came from a woman named Helen Lane.
It gets back to the family again. You talk about the family learning about all of this, and you had to contact the family at a certain point when you were writing this book, and that became a challenge unto itself. What were the problems in trying to contact the Lax family?
Well, the initial problem was that they didn't want to be found. So just actually physically tracking them down and finding phone numbers for them was very challenging. And at a certain point, I found them through this one researcher who had contact with them because he had set up a conference in Henrietta's honor. And even convincing him to put me in touch with them was this very long hazing process. I mean, he essentially interviewed me for many hours before deciding he trusted me. So it took me, in the end, it took me about a year and a half to convince the family to talk to me. And, you know, the first time that I got Deborah Lax on the phone, who is Henrietta's daughter, it was a very pivotal moment in the reporting process for me, because I didn't know anything had happened to the family. It turns out that really a lot of the stories of the legacy of Henrietta Sells, it actually turns out that that's about what happened to her family and the traumatic things that happened to them after they found out about the cells. But I didn't know any of that. So I just thought I was writing about Henrietta and these cells. And I got her daughter on the phone, and her daughter said things. She was obviously very excited about the idea of someone writing a book about her mother. She kept saying, maybe then we'll figure out what these cells are and mm-hmm. what they did and what happened to my mother. And then she sort of panicked, and she was worried that I was going to steal her cells, and then she hung up on me. So for them, I was just yet another person who was going to come and essentially cause problems in their life.
Even when you got to the point of having the family trust you, it was still a rocky relationship with Deborah, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was. She would, you know, we would travel together. And part of how I convinced her to eventually trust me was by saying, you know, I am not going to hide anything from you. We can learn about your mother together. You can come with me when I do my research. So we would travel together a lot. And it turns out, you know, in the history of the family, there was a lot of information withheld from them, and that was part of what was traumatizing for them. I guess to sort of help to backtrack a little bit and say that, you know, when her family first found out about the cells, mm-hmm. this was in the 1970s, and scientists contacted the family because they wanted to do research on Henrietta's kids in order to learn more about the cells, basically. Mm-hmm. Henrietta's husband had a third grade education. He didn't know what a cell was. So he understood the phone call to say, we've got your wife. She's alive in the laboratory. We've been doing research on her for the last 25 years. And now we have to test your kids to see if they have cancer.
And you said at one point that they thought that Henrietta was locked up in a cell.
Yeah, her husband, you know, his only reference point for the word cell was the kind in a prison. So he thought they had her in a cell, like a prison cell. And eventually they figured out that she wasn't still alive. Like, they couldn't go visit her in the way that she had been before she died. But what it meant to have part of her alive was very unclear to them. And particularly Deborah. I mean, she's a very spiritual woman. She very much believed her mother's soul was alive in these cells. And she would say things like, you know, when you shoot my mother's cells up to the moon and you inject them with chemicals, does that hurt her somehow? And can she rest in peace when you're doing all this? And the scientists just had no idea how to respond to her. You know, and then various other things happened. Her mother's medical records were released to the press and published. And,
right.
you know, there were con artists who came along trying to steal her mother's medical records. And so as I learned the story, I understood more and more why Deborah was so mistrustful of me.
Yeah. One of the great ironies of this whole thing is that while medical researchers are making millions off of these cells, the Lacks family can't even get health care.
Yes, that is one of the big contentious parts of the story, that right here, Henrietta's cells helped launch this multi-billion dollar industry. I mean, you can buy them online for $200 a vial just for the cells, or you can buy products made using them up to about $10,000 a vial. And her kids are very poor. They, to this day, don't have health insurance and also don't have just money for a lot of basic living. And that's always been very difficult for them. And they've said, you know, if our mother was so important to medicine, why can't we go to the doctor? And if people are buying and selling these things, essentially, where's our cut? And that's never really been settled.
Well, you know, it's evident to anybody who reads the book what a wonderful book it is. And it seems to me one of the most amazing things that I heard later on was the battles that you had with the editors. And in particular, it had something to do with the choice that you make in the book, in the narrative, to include your story in there, which I think is perfect, your story of how, of the problems, the ups and downs with the Lacks family in terms of getting in touch with them.
One of the editors who inherited the book in that process wanted me to actually take the family out of the book entirely. So, you know, he essentially just wanted me to write a book about the cells. And
Wouldn't have been the
woman they came from, but really he was just interested in the cells. And so he wanted me not just to take the part about me up, but like the whole family story. And I just said, there's no way I'm doing that. I mean, the story is, you know, the family in so many ways. And that's part of what I wanted to do with the book, is to show that there are human beings behind every biological sample out there that we use in the laboratory, and that, you know, there are these sort of lives that surround it. And so, yeah, I wasn't going to do it. I got in a long sort of battle to get my book away from that publishing house. And what was interesting is that I was actually the one who was resistant to having myself in the book. And you know, I teach writing, and I often say to my students, you know, stop inserting yourself into other people's stories, you know, where you don't belong. And I actually get annoyed with writers who just sort of put themselves in stories for no reason. And, you know, so I was very resistant to doing it at all. I kept saying, it's their story, it's not my story. And then at some point I realized that I had actually become a character in their story. It wasn't that it was my story of trying to get the story, but that I was yet another journalist or, you know, person who'd come along and had a pretty big effect on them, in some cases positive, in some cases pretty dangerous. Mm-hmm. There are a lot of things that the book is about, and one of them, there's sort of this undercurrent of, you know, it's about the effect that journalists can have on people's lives, whether they mean it or not, or whether they are even sort of aware of what they're doing.
What was the reaction of the Lax family to the book?
The Lax family's reaction to the book was positive, and they read it before it came out. So I sent a box of pre-publication proofs to Baltimore, and a lot of them read it. And it took about maybe a week or so for them to read it, which was a very long week for me, waiting to hear back. But you know, their initial reaction, I mean, I got this phone call where there were, I think, like six or seven of them on one line, and, you know, all sort of screaming and very excited about it. And for them, you know, there was this sense of, okay, finally the story's going to get out there, and people are going to understand, you know, what happened, and Henrietta will sort of get credit. They really wanted people to know what these cells had done and that they came from Henrietta. Mm-hmm. But really, one of the things which I think they didn't necessarily see coming on the front end was that they learned a lot in the process. There was a lot that they just didn't know about Henrietta, about the cells, about the scientists. So for them, reading the book also helped complete this historic picture for the family.
When I saw you at the book signing, you were talking about the fact that some of the members of the family actually enjoyed the adulation.
And a lot of them would come to my events. You know, I did this 4-month-long book tour where I did events every single day, so all over the country. And when I was on the East Coast, New York and Baltimore and D.C., they would come to my events and answer questions from the audience. And it was great because they're always late for everything. This is just like a rule with the Lack family. And so they would often come in just sort of in the middle of an event, and I would be talking or answering questions, and they would, you know, maybe anywhere from 4 to like 12 or 15 of them would walk in a room, and yeah, the audience would just cheer, and scientists would stand up and say, you know, this is what I used your mother's cells for, and I'm sorry that this was hard for you, and thank you. Mm-hmm. And I wish someone had told you what was going on. And people were asking for their autographs, and, you know, so for them, that response was really, I think there was some healing and closure in that for them, seeing, because they really, you know, it took me 11 years to actually write the book and get it out there. And I think at a certain point, they kind of didn't believe it was really going to happen. And then I think a lot of them believed that maybe people wouldn't really care once it did get out, because no one had particularly cared before. And seeing the response that people are having to the book is, I think, validating for them in a sense.
You know, the tenacity involved in researching the book, contacting the family, and going through all the various parts of the story. Your family observed this and made an observation. You might want to finish that thought, because I can't remember if it was your father or your mother.
Well, really all of them. I mean, my brother too. You know, when the book finally, you know, came out and people started reading it, one of the responses that I often get is, how did you keep going? Like, what made you not give up? And every time they would sort of send you away and all these crazy things would happen, and like, you know, what makes you that tenacious to sort of follow the story? And my family, all of them, just think that's a pretty hilarious question, because, you know, for them, they're just like, that side of you was such a pain when you were a kid.
because you never knew when to leave. That was the main thing.
Well, and it was this sort of when I decide that I want to do something, like, I'm going to do it, and no one can tell me that I'm not going to be able to do it. And it got me in a lot of trouble as a kid. I got kicked out of several schools, and, you know, I think the only reason I graduated from high school is because I ended up going to, as a sort of last effort, going to this alternative high school that essentially just didn't have the same kind of rules and structure that a normal high school did, and they sort of left me to do things on my own, and I was like, great, okay, you know, I'll do things my way, and that works. And It's also why, probably why I've been a career freelancer. So yes, it's a personality trait.
And now it's going to be made into a movie.
Yes, it is.
Yeah. That's pretty exciting.
Yeah. It's very exciting, yeah. And the people who are making it into a movie are especially exciting. So Oprah Winfrey and Alan Ball are going to co-produce it, who are both just incredible and sort of perfect for this story. And they're doing it for HBO,
Alan
Ball,
6 feet Under.
Alan Ball, yes, he's 6 feet Under, and now he's quite famous for doing True Blood, which is this current series that he's working on. And also he did American Beauty and Towelhead. He adopted that from a novel. And I've always been a fan of his work. And it's in a lot of his stuff, even though he kind of sometimes tends towards the supernatural, True Blood is in a lot of ways about life in the South and discrimination and living with that. And so a lot of his work revolves around issues that are actually central themes in the book. And also there is some element of supernatural undertones throughout the book about, Henrietta sort of being out there doing things with her cells, which I think also probably attracted him some. And Oprah, it's such a perfect story for her. And
of course.
I was really thrilled to have them involved, in part because, one of my concerns with having a movie of the book at all was I wanted to make sure this wasn't something else that happened to the family, that didn't get sort of fictionalized to the point where it would be putting more misinformation out there. I didn't want to demonize the scientists, so I was worried about how that would be handled. And then, when the three components who are involved got involved, I just thought, well, I'm not worried. I mean, I know they're going to...
Yeah, it's definitely in good hands.
Yeah,
now.
It's in good hands.
Rebecca, thank you so much for taking the time to talk to us.
Thanks for having me.
And not to put any pressure on you, but I can't wait to see your next project.
Thank you.